happy and honored to open this B20 G20 dialogue jointly organized by the B20 Health, Life and Science Task Force and Novartis. The B20 G20 dialogue are key opportunities for business and also, I hope, for the G20 presidency to share priorities and objectives with the common aim of preventing emerging global health challenges. Today's one will take stock of the recent declarations following the high-level meetings of the World Health Assembly and the Global Health Summit to further discuss the creation of innovative and sustainable care models in the post-pandemic recovery agenda. We chose to have for the very first time in the B20 history, this task force of health, life and science, which is I think very important. I really want to thank Sergio Dompei for his brilliant and very important charge. As B20, we call on governments to intensify collaboration with industry and to incentivize investment in research and development, especially those devoted to unfold new technological frontiers, such as the mRNA, that has allowed the to develop advanced vaccine for COVID-19. So Sergio Dompei, that, as I said, has mastered the Health, Life and Science Task Force of our B20.
Importance of creating value-based health systems. Really investing in health systems, not to get more of the usual or more of the same, but really to transform health systems that are fit for today and for the future. We see a very important role for G20, having a strategic role and a leadership role in establishing a global health board, similar to the Financial Stability Board, as we move forward through a stronger WHO, but with collaboration of health and finance ministers to develop this new agenda.
When we reflect on the recent pandemic, you can clearly see that collaborations across industry, academia, civil society has enabled us for a once-in-a-generation pandemic to come to a once-in-a-generation response. The ability of science, technology, R&D efforts to bring forward vaccines at the scale that our industry has been able to bring in collaboration with all of these stakeholders, working with regulators and government, to find medicines that we could repurpose to effectively treat COVID in the ICU, to develop a next wave, we hope, of medicines to come that can hopefully treat this devastating disease, I think is a powerful testament to when we get these communities together, these stakeholders together, working on a common goal with an aligned vision, we can accomplish extraordinary things. Not only did the pandemic expose inequities in healthcare systems and inequities in how communities receive care, it also heightened, I think, the awareness and impact of challenges such as cancer, cardiovascular disease, respiratory diseases, and other non-communicable diseases. Most recently, we have endeavored with the UK government to tackle cardiovascular disease at scale with a partnership that combines novel clinical trials, manufacturing collaboration, and taking on lipid lowering or cholesterol lowering in patients who had prior heart attacks. This collaboration has had to bring together various elements of the government, private sector, also nonprofits that support this, in order to really take on the UK's goal of reducing the 150,000 deaths that occur from cardiovascular disease, heart attacks in the country. I believe that in the future, this is going to be the model that will really enable us to take on some of these very significant challenges in the G20 countries, the commitment to a bold goal to really reduce cardiovascular disease and generate significant outcomes. And I think we have to also sign up for that as a global health community, that we really want to tackle these non-communicable diseases at scale.
What are we asked to do by the WHO European Pan-European Office? We are asked to reconsider policy priorities in the light of the pandemics. So that means that the pandemics has thrown light on a number of weaknesses, which in our view go well beyond pandemic phenomenon itself, and have very, very much to do with the overall context of health policy, economic policies, financial policies, and policies in general. Our Commission proposes that the G20 should be, in fact, the body to carry on a strategic overview over time, indefinitely, on health and sustainable development, even when, hopefully, this will no longer be the overriding priorities of heads of governments and presidents. We also proposed already back in March that the G20 should establish within itself a global health board, very much along the lines of the Financial Stability Board when it was set up in 2009 after the big financial crisis. Biodiversity and health should be incorporated in the public goods aspect, for which a smart use of the public policy regulations and levers could help also private finance to be conveyed to these essential public goods purposes. So let's make sure that the accounting notions on which these controls and these recommendations are made reflect more adequately the long-term economic interests of society, in which a resilient health system has, of course, a major role.
The pandemic has revealed important limitations in the ability, for example, of real-time data that allows patients, that follows patients along their care pathways. If we look at OECD countries from a survey of 23 countries, we found that only 8 were able to report real-time data for primary care and 7 real-time data for prescription of medicines. In particular, we build resilience against pandemics by increasing the health capital of our population, by tackling non-communicable diseases so we have a healthier population. We also build resilience against pandemics by making sure we have a health system that passes information quickly and seamlessly between different parts of the system so we can make the right decisions on both a macro and individual basis in real time. And then finally, we build resilience by integrating care so we're better care at the appropriate level.
It's all about solidarity, the healthy, wealthy, helping the sick and the poor, the private sector working with the public sector. So this was almost like the ultimate test for solidarity in health. And this is now the opportunity for the G20 to step up. And I think on those 3 key asks, sharing vaccines, providing public financing, and speeding up tech transfers.
We need a global network of surveillance and research to prevent and detect emerging infectious disease. We need a resilient national system in order to strengthen our global pandemic preparedness and response. We need a better supply of medical countermeasures and tools in order to shorten the response time to a pandemic and deliver equitable global access to these control tools. And then we need global governance to ensure that the system is better coordinated, is properly funded, is more transparent, there is a clear accountability in the outcomes. We need to invest now billions if we want to save trillions in the near future. And we are also aware that the money alone will not deliver a safer world without a stronger governance. And the conclusion is that the current global health architecture needs some improvement if we want to prevent a future major pandemic, and if we want to respond with speed, with force, when a new pandemic threat emerges.
Innovation is the key to go ahead. No ways. Secondly, to go appropriately with this, you need a value-based healthcare. The value-based healthcare is the key. And third, we have to think about the sustainability. of the systems, not only of the cost of the single sources, but all the system together. We need to act a revolution, and we need to use this moment in Rome to make the change. So we are extremely positive about the capacity of Mario Draghi and the whole of the government to make this change. And our ask strong is, please ask which are the proposals of the science and the industry, and use what you think is appropriate. But if there is a moment without the never so strong is to act now.